Hello everybody, Felix here, and before we get into the video, I wanted to do some self-promotion. I have a Discord server and a website now, which are linked down in the description if you want to check them out. And now, onto our regularly scheduled program. Today, I wanted to give you a guide on how to defeat the CEO. Most guides are outdated since Toontown and Redden has given the CEO fight some major changes, so I decided to give my own guide. Hopefully you find this helpful, and without further ado, let's jump right into it. The first thing you'll do when you enter the CEO fight is do a cog battle with cogs of levels 9 through 12. Regardless of how many toons you brought with you on the elevator, if there's at least two, there will be two battles and the game will split you up as evenly as it can. If you've decided to solo the CEO, then it will just be your battle. However, this battle will be a little different. Other than cog golf courses or invasions, this is the only time you will encounter version 2.0 cogs. Version 2.0 cogs essentially have two lives, which means you will need to defeat them twice. When they still have their suit, they have damage resistance scaled by their level. Higher levels mean more damage resistance. Once you've defeated the version 2.0 cog once, you will be left with a skele-cog that takes damage normally. Also, any extra damage you deal to a version 2.0 cog will not damage the skele-cog. The only way to damage both the suit and the skele-cog in the same turn is to defeat the suit with one gag, and then damage the skele-cog with a gag that goes after the previous one. If you didn't already guess it, battle strategies need to be modified for version 2.0 cogs. Generally, you won't be using sound around them except in rare cases. It's better to get rid of them first with lure because their damage resistance makes them basically soundproof. Also, you need to use more powerful gags to get rid of them. I'm going to post a handy chart on the screen that shows what can and can't defeat version 2.0 cogs. You can pause your video if you'd like to view it. If my chart is missing something that I didn't think of, feel free to let me know. After the version 2.0 cogs are defeated, use sound. Repeat that process until all the cogs are defeated. After you defeat all the cogs in the first fight, you'll proceed to the feeding round. Since this is also when you'll get your first peek at the cogs at their tables, this is a good time to also talk about the amount of fires you'll earn and how the cogs at the tables can help you determine this. First, to understand why you get a different amount of fires for certain CEOs, I need to talk about how the game determines this. The game will take the number of promotions everyone in your group has earned and add one to that value. For example, if you bring someone whose disguise is a level 2 flunky, they've earned one promotion. Add one, and the game gives their suit a value of 2. After the game determines what everyone's suit value is, the game will average it out by dividing how many players are present. That is the number the game will work with. If the value is between 1 and 16, you will earn 2 pink slips. If the value is between 17 and 32, you'll get 3 pink slips. If the value is between 33 and 47, you'll get 4 pink slips. If the value is between 48 and 64, you will get 5 pink slips. If the value is 65 or higher, you'll get 6 pink slips. If all that math went in one ear and out the other, or you just don't feel like doing math, don't worry, neither do I. There's a much easier way to tell how many pink slips you'll get, and it has to do with the cogs at the tables. First, you can determine whether or not you're getting an odd or even amount of fires very easily. Except for 6 slip runs, which will have big cheeses, if you see corporate raiders, you know you're earning an even number of slips. If you see big cheeses, you're earning an odd number of slips unless it's 6. Another way to look at it is that if you see corporate raiders, you know you're either getting 2 or 4 pink slips. Next, to determine exactly how many slips you're getting, you just need to look at how many cogs and tables there are. You could count the exact number to know for sure, but it's easier to make a general observation instead of counting. If you see a lot of cogs and tables, you know there's a higher amount of fires. If you see only a few cogs and tables, you know there's a lower amount of fires. When you pair that up with the above knowledge, you can usually get a pretty good idea of how many pink slips you're going to get without doing any math. Okay, and now on to the actual feeding round. If you're wondering why I'm using footage from someone else for this segment, well, let's just say my computer is very slow and recordings turn into slideshows when there's a lot of movement going on. The original footage is credited in the description. Anyways, there is a system to the feeding round. You should not feed random cogs. First, you need to know whether you're going to the left or the right side of the room. If you're closer to the left, you go to the left. If you're closer to the right, you go to the right. After that, prioritize cogs based on their proximity to your conveyor belt. This means you start with the cogs just a few steps away, and as time goes on, you move further away. Also, don't forget to share the responsibility of tables in the middle with the other side. However, that's not everything. Unless you're in a 2 or 3 fire run where it doesn't usually matter as much, you should also prioritize the version 2.0 cogs, aka the VIP cogs. You'll be able to tell that they're a version 2.0 cog for a few reasons. First, in front of them on their table, they will have a VIP card while normal cogs won't have anything in front of them. Secondly, if they're a big cheese, then they will be leaning back in their chair. Corporate raiders will be leaning on their arm. And finally, if you watch them closely, you'll notice that they're much more animated than normal cogs. You want to prioritize version 2.0 cogs for two reasons. First, they take 3 cans of oil instead of 2. And secondly, when the feeding round ends, you'll have to fight all the cogs you did not feed. It's much easier to only deal with normal cogs, so it's good to get rid of the version 2.0s. Once the timer runs out or all the cogs have been fed, the feeding round will end. After the feeding round ends, it's time for the second cog fight. No matter what, this will always start with a level 12 version 2.0 big cheese. Some people will use a pink slip on it, but some don't. Personally, I do because the cog is just annoying. No matter how you get rid of the level 12, you will have to fight any other cogs that you did not finish feeding in the feeding round. If there were no other cogs, you won't have to fight anymore and proceed to the CEO round instead. Any cogs left over from the feeding round keep the damage done to them from any oil they did drink. The second fight will usually go faster than the first since you're usually dealing with a lot of cogs that are at least partially damaged. A lot of people like to spam trunks with a few other gags mixed in until they get to cogs that didn't have any damage done to them. And after all the cogs are defeated, it's time for the CEO round. The CEO round has quite a bit of information to go over, so I'll try to make it as digestible as possible. First, let's go over the few attacks the CEO has. The first one that you absolutely need to know about is his 4 attack. This attack will start when the CEO will shout 4. A few seconds later, golf balls will be launched towards every tune. It's important to note that the CEO will track your location based on your tune's exact location when he says 4. So as long as you move to the side or backwards, you will not get hit. You can also get hit by golf balls being launched at another player, so keep that in mind if you're running around the room when he says this, or if there's somebody behind you. The next attack the CEO has is throwing gears. This one will happen pretty fast, and the only warning will be the CEO suddenly turning to look at someone. So if you notice the CEO turning to look at you, then you might want to move out of the way just in case. Subjectively, I think this one is the hardest attack to avoid. The third attack is very similar to the 4 attack, except it's golf balls only being launched at one player, he does not give a verbal warning, and the attack doesn't seem to track your vertical position. This is because if the CEO throws golf balls and you're on a table, you're safe and you don't have to move anywhere. But if you're golfing or on the ground in general, then you're no longer safe from this attack unless you get out of the way just like you would for a 4 attack. The last direct attack the CEO has is running over other tunes or in general just touching him. After the CEO has left the fireplace and is around the tables, he will only ever move as far as the edge and corner tables. This means if you're on a table or on the ground in this area, you're at risk of being run over by the CEO, and you need to keep your eye on where he is. If you get crushed under the CEO, be wary that it might be a little while before he decides to move away if you're especially unlucky. Okay, and that's it for the CEO's attacks. Now let's talk about your attacks to the CEO. First of all, the only way you can do damage to the CEO is by using the seltzer bottles on the tables. You press and hold your action key, and when you want to spray the seltzer, you release the button. You can either fire with blue, yellow, or red power to do 3 varying increments of damage. More charged seltzer will also squirt further. Blue will do 6 damage, yellow does 12, and red does 24, but is pretty difficult to get just right. Personally, for strategies, I recommend releasing just before it looks red so you'll safely do either 12 or 24 damage with relative consistency throughout the CEO, except for when he's close where you can opt for a bunch of short bursts of damage instead. Of course, that's just my personal opinion, and I don't have any math or numbers to say that strategy is any better than something else. The second attack you can do to the CEO is pretty indirect and doesn't actually do any damage. Instead, it slows him down. And that's golfing. Golfing doesn't do much if you're not doing it consistently, but if you work at it enough, then the CEO will actually get slowed down a lot. Only one or two people should golf, but I've seen three or even four people start on golf and go to Seltzer's later so they can get the CEO slowed down much faster than a typical run. However you decide to do it is up to your group though. And finally, Tune Up. At first, your main forms of Tune Up should be the conveyor belts at each side of the room. However, this is a temporary solution because the CEO will deactivate the conveyor belts. The first time he'll do this is shortly after his health turns orange. He'll say it's time to reorganize, and throw gears at the conveyor belt that's to the left if you're facing the fireplace, and to the right if you're facing the doors. His attacks will also do more damage. Once the CEO's health turns red, he'll shut down the last conveyor belt and say, now let's downsize, and will now deal even more damage. After one or both of the conveyor belts have been shut down, I'd recommend one of three options instead. The first and riskiest is to pretty much just run around the edge of the map, hoping to basically be immune to all attacks and rely on everyone else to carry you to the rest of the CEO. I personally have no issues with people doing this if their lap is red, but others might find it annoying and even attempt to green you. Another option is to ask someone to squirt you with a seltzer bottle, or even just stand in front of someone's seltzer and essentially force them to give you some tune-up. The only downside of this is that seltzers give very little tune-up, so this will be a pretty lengthy process to get any meaningful amount of laugh. The third and final option is tune-up unites, be it from you or somebody else. I personally wouldn't try to rely on the generosity of other toons to throw their tune-up unites, and especially if you're new to the CEO, I would recommend bringing a unite or even two unites for yourself, just to be cautious. Well, that's it for my CEO guide. I hope you found this tutorial helpful, and if I missed anything or if you'd like to add something, then be sure to let me know in the comments. With that, I'll see you on the next one. Bye!